Hi, this is Rhett with testingtheory.com, and today we're going to talk about A-B testing statistics, and we're going to make them simple and an easy way to understand them. We're going to talk about some important definitions and key concepts you need to understand, things like lift and conversion and population and sample size and confidence and statistical significance, confidence intervals, p-values, all these things that you need to understand and have a concept of in order to properly interpret tests so you understand the stats behind the engine of the testing tool that you're using. It's important to understand these key concepts so that you know what the data means, and as you interpret the data, you know how to call good testing winners. To be clear though, this video isn't about interpreting results. I have a whole other video on the four things you need to properly and successfully interpret results and to call winners, so please see that video. This video will focus on not necessarily the things you need to call a winner, but the concepts you need to understand to know the statistics behind the A-B testing that you're doing. The first concept they're going to talk about is the population. The population is all the potential visitors for your digital property. Now, let's take a simple example so you understand what this means. Suppose that we want to know the population of all the students at a university. You might just walk in and say, oh, here's the population. But you've got students who are sick, students at home, students doing online learning, students who may be studying or on vacation or out of state. So you've got the population, which is the total whole of all the people in question. With your website or your digital property, your population is your total potential visitors, those who have come to your site and those who might be coming to your site. With testing, we use a sample size. And the sample is a subset of the entire population. So in the university example, if you walked into the university and you start asking a few people some questions, you now have a sample of the larger population. But keep in mind, the sample never is the entire population. With an A-B test, your sample is hopefully 100% of the people coming to the website or to your digital property during the time of the test. The more that you limit the sample, the less confidence you have in your data. We're going to talk more about why in just a second. But your sample size is your subset of the population that's being tested. There are two very important parts of the sample size that you need to understand. The first is a random sampling, and the second is that you want it to be representative. The randomness of your sample is important. You don't want to predetermine who gets into your sample because you want an unbiased result. The more that you allow people to randomly enter your test, the more confident you can be in the data. The second thing is representative sample. Most often for an A-B test, you want your sample size to be as large as possible to represent the whole. Again, think of the people who aren't coming to the site during this time period where you're testing. That entire population is not represented because they're not coming into the test. And so the larger you make your sample size, the more representative it will be. Representative sample size in A-B testing also means that you are analyzing and applying the results of a test to the population that it represents. If you do a homepage test and you learn something important about your visitors, you can't necessarily apply that learning to the rest of your site because that you didn't test on a representative sample of the rest of the site. And so a representative sample is important because it dictates how you can apply the learnings of your test. It also helps you understand the confidence in the results of the test. Okay, let's start with another simple one. The next thing I want to define for you is lift. Lift is a simple calculation. It's your new conversion rate minus your old conversion rate divided by the old conversion rate. And basically what this is telling you is how much is the increase or decrease in the change. So is it better or is it worse? And if it is better, by what percent? Your lift tells you the percent that the variation you're testing is better or worse than the control. I've talked about confidence already. Let's define that and talk about that. There's a few different ways that people talk about confidence. It could be called statistical significance. It could be called just plain confidence, or it could be called plain significance. All of these are different ways of interpreting the statistics behind your result. So what does statistical significance mean? It means if you were to repeat this test, that percent is the likelihood of you seeing the same result. So if you have a 95% confidence, you would say that if you were to rerun this test, 95% of the time, you would expect to see the same results. In order to make this easy to help understand, think about it this way. Suppose you have a friend who sometimes lies to you. And if they lie 95% of the time, you have to understand that not everything they say is true, but 95% of the time, you can trust what they say. So that's the same with your test result. The statistical confidence doesn't mean you're 100% accurate. It means that 95% of the time, or 90% of the time, whichever the statistical confidence number is, you can expect to see those same results. 95% of the time, or 90% of the time, you might expect your friend to be lying to you. So mostly you're going to be right, but sometimes you might be wrong. Again, it's one measure to help you interpret the data. Again, that's why I say please look at my other video on how to interpret test results. There you can get the things you should be looking at to interpret good tests. Statistical significance is a value that fluctuates. If you look at this graph found on optimizely.com, you can see that the significance is constantly going up and down. And that's because as you get more data, more of your samples, the results of that test become more confident. So if your main conversion rate is lead generation on your site, your conversion rate is calculated by taking your total leads divided by the total visitors in the test. That gives you your conversion rate or the average data point that you're looking at. Sometimes this is called the mean, like what's the middle, what's the average. So your conversion rate is fluctuating based on the number, the people that you're getting in the test. So if you get several visitors that come and they sign up and you generate a lead, and then in a different sample of visitors, you get a few, several that don't sign up and don't become a lead, those combine to offset the statistical confidence of your results. So when they all sign up, it goes up, and then when they all don't sign up, it goes down with your new sample population. So as you get more people into the test, your conversion rate will solidify over time, and your statistical confidence will solidify over time as well. So you see at first it's initially fluctuating, and then it gets to a point where it starts to average out because you've got more data and you're more confident in the results of that data. So if you have low statistical confidence, it just means that your test probably isn't a winner. If you have high statistical confidence, it means there's lots of repeatability there and it's likely is a winner. It's important to note though that statistical significance alone isn't a stopping rule. It means you never want to call your test based on that one number alone. Again, look at my other video on how to interpret results. So closely connected to your significance or your statistical confidence is your p-value. If you've done any statistics courses, you've talked about p-value. You know that you want a low p-value. The lower the p-value, the more you can trust those that data set being repeatable. The more you can trust the probability of that result. Again, the p-value, the confidence number, it doesn't tell you if A is better than B. It tells you how much you can trust that result, how surprising that result might be. In a typical research study, people are looking for a p-value of less than 0.05%. In testing, we would say you have a 95% confidence in that result. So in statistics, you want low p-values and you want high statistical confidence because that means your results are repeatable and you can trust those results. This brings us to our next definition, which is your confidence interval. Because we're sampling the population and we don't have the entire population, like we talked about, the confidence is changing based on the data that comes in. So the confidence interval is the range of expected outcomes. Let me give you a simple example of what a confidence interval looks like in the real world. So suppose you have a friend that's coming to visit you, and the friend says, hey, I'm on my way, I'll be there in 40 minutes, give or take 10 minutes. So the conversion rate is 40 minutes, the time to arrival is 40 minutes, and the give or take, that plus or minus 10 minutes on either side, could be 50 minutes or it could be 30 minutes, that give or take, that range, is the confidence interval. So if your conversion rate is 20%, give or take, or plus or minus 5%, then that gives you the confidence interval or the range for that rate. And so the interval just helps you know how sure the data is. So suppose the friend says, I'll be there in 40 minutes, plus or minus an hour. Then you're like, whoa, I'm not really sure when you're going to be here, because it could be an hour and 40 minutes, or it could be, minus an hour. Like, I'll be there in just 1 minute. So the wider the range, the less confident you are in the results. It's the same with the test you're running. If you have a very wide interval, a lift interval or a confidence interval, then you're less certain in that result. Let's use a simple example of lead generation. If you have 10 visitors come to your site and 5 of them sign up, that's a 50% conversion rate. If and you have 10 visitors come and you only have 2 sign up, then that's a 20% conversion rate. And so your confidence is fluctuating based on the number of people signing up. Meaning, if again, you get the 10 people that come to your site and 5 people sign up, that confidence interval is showing that the range could be, you know, if the range, confidence is 50%, but the range could be as high as 99 or could be as low as, you know, 10%. And then as you get more data, that confidence interval will tighten up because you have more data to confirm that variation is causing that lead generation or that rate of lead generation. So at 10 visitors, you might have a really large confidence interval because the data is unsure. But as you get 1,000 or 1,000,000 visitors, then your confidence intervals get very, very tight because the expected range of outcomes averages out to be very tight over time. So initially, what was a 50% confidence or 50% conversion rate with a large confidence interval becomes, if it still is 50%, a 50% conversion rate with a very tight confidence interval, because so much more data has come in than now that we know the result of that data set. Because we're sampling the population and every person who comes into the sample responds differently, you get sampling error or variations, just variance in the amount of change between one visitor to the next visitor. And so that difference in the visitors is what causes your confidence interval. It's the range of outcomes. The more data you have, the tighter your range. The less data you have, the bigger the range of potential outcomes. The key concept here is knowing that if you have a very small confidence or lift interval, that is good because you can be more sure that the change is actually causing that lift or conversion. You want very tight confidence intervals, very tight lift intervals, because that shows that you're more likely to get that result. One thing to look out for with a confidence interval is if you see a range here and then a range here and they overlap, that overlapping between the variations shows that your potential outcomes aren't so certain because you have the range itself as being overlapping. It's important to understand there's also a law of diminishing returns with trying to tighten the confidence interval. If you get more data, it will tighten the interval. But there comes a point where the more collecting more data doesn't really help you drastically because the interval is pretty much set. So you want tight intervals and you want more data to get those tight confidence intervals, but there comes a point of diminishing returns where you don't need more data. So here's a simple example that I found online with that shows the range and the confidence of some results from VWO. You can see the variation 1 has a 70% confidence or a statistical significance level, while variation 2 has 100%. Technically, it's never 100%, it's probably like 99 point whatever, but they're showing that V2 is more likely to be repeatable if you were to rerun that test. Now, look to the left. You'll see that the confidence interval or the conversion rate range is very different between the two. So you've got 54% plus or minus 5.2% in V1, and you've got a conversion rate of 76% plus or minus 5.4% in V2. And so the plus or minus means that it could be plus 5 higher or plus 5 lower. And so that because those ranges aren't overlapping, on the V1 at the highest, the most it could be is 59%. V2, the lowest it could be, is 71%. And so that range helps you understand how overlapping the data, how much there's overlap in the data, and how confident we can be in the range of results that are possible. I want to walk through a simple example of what this looks like in real life for a real test. Suppose you run a test and you have one variation. And as you start collecting data, your total population is the total number of people that could come to the test. Now, during your testing time period, you won't have everyone. So the population is undefined because you don't know who's going to be there. But your sample size is the people who actually enter the test. So each variation will have 50% of the traffic. So your sample is 50% of the population that come to the site during that test. Now, as people start to convert on your site, whether it's lead generation or average order or your order value, people are making orders, the conversion rate is your key metric for this test. And you want to know if your conversion rate is increasing with your variation, and so you want to know the lift. The lift is the increase of the conversion rate of the variation that you're testing. Now, once you see that one variation has a good increase in lift, you want to know if you can trust that lift, if it's real or if it's just because of you don't have enough of data yet, or if you want to be able to say, hey, this is truly a lift when you're ready to call the test results. So you might look at something like this statistical confidence. Now remember that the more data that you collect, the more visitors that get into your variations, the more likely you are to have a higher statistical confidence if that number truly is real. Now, initially it will fluctuate, but over time you'll start to see that with more people purchasing, more people converting, you'll get more confidence in the test result and your statistical confidence will increase. This also means that your p-value will decrease, and it also means that your confidence interval will tighten up because you're collecting more data. If there's something else you'd like me to cover about the statistics behind A/B testing, please leave a comment below so I know that topic is of interest to you, and I'd be happy to address those in a future video. Thanks for joining me today. I hope this has been helpful for you. If you did find it helpful, please hit the like button. You can also subscribe to my channel. I post new videos every Thursday. And testingtheory.com is where professional testers come to do better testing and get more conversions.